Hello, 你好，欢迎回来 ，Welcome back to True History Thursday with Johnny Tiger on August 31st, 2023. Well, at the last day of August, so I think this is a good time for me to teach you guys how to say the 12 months in Mandarin. That is not related to our topic of the day, but I thought it would be an interesting thing to learn and pretty useful, actually. Now, those of you who already know that the Mandarin, the Chinese, how to say from 1 to 10, this would be very simple. So let's start with that. Let's quickly review counting 1 to 10 in Chinese or in Mandarin, shall we say. 1 is yi, that's Y-E, yi. 2 is er, like E-R, er. 3 is san, san, like S-U-N, almost. 4 is 四, like 四, like th, almost like a the kind of sound, 四. 5 is 五, w. 6 is 六, l-i-u, Leo. Or Leo, you can think of the name Leo and just say Leo. That's 6. 7 is Qi, C-H-E-E, Qi. 8 is Ba, B-A, Ba. 9 is Jill, J-I-L-L, like the name Jill. Or you can think of the name J-O-E, Joe. So Joe, either way works. Number 10, 十, like a S H E, you got to kind of curl your tongue a little bit. 十. Now this one's confusing for a lot of people. Number 10 and number 4. The number 4 is 四. Number 10 is 十. So number 10, you'll do it almost like you're trying to whistle 十, and then number 4 is more forceful. You put the tongue to the roof of your mouth and si, si, like that. So again, 1, 2, 3, yi, er, san, 4, 5, 6, si, wu, liu, 7, 8, 9, qi, ba, jiu, and 10, shi, and then 11, shi yi, 12, shi er, 13, shi san, 14, 14, 15, 15, and then 16, 17, 18, 19, and then 20 is 20. Okay, so once you learn from 1 to 10, you are basically taken care of all the way up to 100. Now, when we tell people what month, then we just basically add the word 月, 月, like y-u-e-a, 月. 月 means moon, the moon in the sky. 月, moon is 月亮, 月亮. So when we say month, we say 月. So January is 一月, first month. February, 二月. March, 三月. April, 四月. May, 五月, June, 六月, July, 七月, August, 八月, September, 九月, October, 十月, November, 十一月, December, 十二月. So once you learn your number, you can say month very, very simple, very easily. I know, yes, I know. we got a black screen going on today. Reason being, I am trying to charge my phone. I didn't want to wait until my phone is charged to do this video because we got a lot of stuff going on today. So I want to try to knock this out of the park when I can. So you guys just have to experience this like how a blind person would and just listen.
Incidentally, I'm curious, for those of you that have eyesight, does it really matter to you if you get to see that tree outside the window? Or does it make any kind of difference when it's a black screen setting like this? When you watch my Wisdom Wednesday or Soul Search Sunday, these more spoken words oriented video, does it really make a difference if you have something to look at or not? So maybe you can let me know in the comment section. Now that we got our vocabulary out of the day, it is time for today's little bit of a true history. And this time is an interesting one. We are going to talk about the various tips and tricks the ancient Chinese royal subject used for self-defense. I know, I'm not talking about self-defense like you're going through a dark alleyway and you have to defend yourself with swords and knives. Not that kind of self-defense. The kind of self-defense we're going to talk about today is even more dangerous, more insidious, because it's self-defense against your emperor. An old Chinese idiom tells us to serve an emperor is like keeping company with a tiger. Today he may be okay, tomorrow he may kill you without a second thought. And honestly, most emperors were not what we see in movies, these ultra wise and old and magnificent and benevolent individuals that forgiving and understanding like what you see in Mulan. No, most emperors, you gotta imagine, most of these guys became emperors when they were like 8 years old. So they gotta go through puberty, they gotta go through like becoming an adult. They got to learn as they went, and there were a lot of temper tantrums. There were a lot of very human traits in emperors throughout the ages. So it is not uncommon for an emperor to just up and have a bad day or just be a little bit hormonal and decide to chop off someone's head and then regret it later, but then it's too late. So as ministers, generals, custodians and servants, a lot of people had to come up with very inventive ways to protect themselves against the wrath of the emperor. So today we are going to look at a couple of these interesting ones. The first commonly used tactic by high-ranking officers and ministers of the court to protect themselves from the displeasure and wrath of their emperor was to defame themselves. Now, this sounds counterintuitive to our modern way of thinking. Like, we think, well, shouldn't you try to have spotless record? Like, shouldn't you try to be as perfect as you can? No. If you listen to our Spoken Word Sunday episode, I believe it was Spoken Word Sunday, where I talked about how emperors actually hated loyal subjects, perfect subjects, then you understand. Most of the time, if you are too perfect, it's a quick way to get yourself killed by the emperor. Because the emperor is perfect. The emperor is perfect. You cannot be more perfect than your emperor. So if people love you, more than they love your emperor, their soul review with Bye Bye, you have to go. It's just that simple. So, a lot of the advisors and royal ministers, when they felt that the emperor may be looking at them with a certain degree of, hey, is this guy really that good? Does everybody love him? How come people love him more than they love me? When they start to get that vibe from their emperor, it is time to do something about it. And the most common tactic is self-defamation. Self-defamation. They will do something, they'll go out of their way to do something naughty to make sure they ruin their own reputation so the emperor wouldn't target them. One big example, and one of the actually quite regrettable individual in Chinese history, is a famous Philippine general from the Song Dynasty by the name of Shi Shouxin. Shi, as in like number 10, number 10, Shi. Shi Shouxin. Shi is his last name, his family name. Shi Shouxin. That is a really good name, by the way. Shouxin means always true to your word, always deliver your promises. So Shi Shouxin means this guy is a very honorable person. And he was, in fact. Shi Shouxin was the Emperor Zhao Guangyin's most loyal general when the emperor was just a military man himself. Before he became the general, Shi Shouxin was his sworn brother. They were like, god brothers. Unfortunately, once the emperor became emperor, then god brother didn't really mean anything anymore. So when his god brother Zhao Guangyin became the emperor of Song Dynasty, Shi Shouxin thought, okay, this is going to be great. My brother will be the emperor, so I will be his general. I'll be his right arm. I'll be his mighty right arm. I'll be his sword. I'll go and conquer for him. I'll defend his kingdom. Everything will be great. And Shi Shouxin was a great guy. Shi Shouxin was extremely honorable, smart, have a spotless reputation, and also a fierce warrior on the battlefield. But you would think a guy like that would be like perfect for emperor to have, right? Well, Emperor Zhao Guangyin didn't think so. Emperor Zhao Guangyin, after he took the throne, he started to feel worried. He started thinking about all his sworn brothers, all the people that fought beside him, and he started to look at them, and he no longer looked at them like allies. He looked at them like, I was just one of them. I wasn't even the best of them. This guy's taller than me. This guy next to him is stronger than me. And this guy is smarter than me. And this guy has more people, more friends than I do. So if I was just one of them and I could be the emperor today, does that mean that any of them can replace me anytime? That's the thought process that was going through Emperor Zhao Guangyin's mind when one day he called a great royal feast and brought together all his old allies and friends and sworn brothers. And during this feast, the emperor stood up and he toasted his old military buddies, his royal advisors, and he said, I remember our time fondly. I remember how great we were as warriors. And every one of you was so great by my side. Every one of you, in your own way, were better than I was. Look at you. He pointed at one of the guys. He said, look at you.
You are taller.
You are so magnificent. And look at you. You are so strong. And look at you. Your sword is unbeatable. And look at you. You have higher education than I do. But look at me today. I'm sitting here. I'm the emperor. And you guys are my loyal subjects. But you know what? Ever since I became emperor, I have not had a single night of sleep. Because all I wonder about is, what if one day one of you decide that you should be the emperor and not me? What do you think I should do about that? As soon as the emperor said this, delivered this little speech, one of these subjects, one of these advisors was Shi Shouxin. Shi Shouxin felt goosebumps going all up and down his back. He knew that this was the day that he had to do something, otherwise the emperor was going to get him killed very, very soon. So, Shi Shouxin, the very next day, Shi Shouxin came to see the emperor and turned in his letter of resignation. I said, hey, I don't feel good. I'm getting sick. I need to resign from my military post. So anyway, here's the royal seal. Here is a commanding document. I will no longer command your army. Please just allow me to take my family and go back to the farm. Now you would think that this was you would think that this would be the perfect solution, but the emperor Zhang Fengyi, to him, this wasn't good enough. Because he realized that Shi Shouxin was so beloved by the civilians. And he said, well, it's good that you turn in your military post. It's good that you no longer command the military. But because the civilians, they love you so much, what if you go back to the farm and start a rebellion? What if you put together your own military and come try to take the throne? I can't allow you to go. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take away your military rank. I'm going to take away your power to command the military. But you are going to stay. You and your family are going to stay here in the capital city. And I'm going to make you one of the minor city officials, so you still work for me, and at the same time, I can keep my eye on you. The unspoken word here is, so I can kill you whenever I feel like it. So, when Shi Shouxin went home, and he realized that he's not out of the danger yet, though he is no longer the leader of the military, the emperor still feels threatened by his popularity because of how much people love him. So from that day on, Shi Shouxin changed. From that day on, Shi Shouxin started to use his power and prestige to embezzle money. He started to abuse his servant. He started to cheat his neighbors. Basically anything do to make people hate him, he did it. And it got to the point that Shi Shouxin contracted to have a new palace built, and then during the building of the palace, he embezzled a large amount of money, and he mistreated all the workers. And because of that, his reputation fell to the bottom. Everybody in the kingdom hated him. Everybody said that Shi Shouxin, no, not a good guy, Shi Shouxin, the devil, the demon, a slave driver, a cheater, and everybody is petitioned to have the emperor get Shi Shouxin executed. But the emperor wasn't angry, the emperor was happy, because now Shi Shouxin was no longer a threat. He didn't have the military, he didn't have the popularity. So after that, the emperor said to Shi Shouxin, oh, look at you, obviously you're doing such a bad job. Look at how everybody hates you. You know what, I'm just going to allow you to go back to the farm. Take your family and go. I don't ever want to see you again. And it was because of that that Shi Shouxin ripe old age, while all his other compatriots, all the other people who stayed to assist the emperor, were either poisoned, murdered, or got sent to exile.
So Shi Shouxing
was able to save his life and his family's life by totally defaming himself and defecating himself, making himself looking like the bad guy in people's eyes. But this was a common trick in loyal subjects of the emperor in the old days. Another famous example was in the case of a general called General Wang in the Qing Dynasty. When King Shi Huang, you know, the guy that built the Great Wall, that first emperor of China, King Shi Huang was putting together a massive army to march to take down the other kingdoms. He wanted to unite the entire China. So one of the guys that was chosen to lead his army was General Wang. And General Wang was an older general, but he was magnificent on the battlefield, a great leader, great tactician. Before he marched out, King Shi Huang summoned General Huang to his palace and said, "You are doing your country a great favor. Tell me, what is it that you want for a reward?" And General Huang said, "Oh, Your Majesty, I just want 50 acres of land for a farm, for my farm. You see, I grew up in a really small farming community. We didn't have a lot of land, so please just give me 50 acres of land." And King Shi Huang laughed in his face. The emperor laughed in his face and said, "For an old general, you really don't have any ambition, do you? Tell you what, I'll give you 100 acres of land for your reward." After General Wang walked out of the palace, his son said to him, "Dad, you are a disgrace. You are so embarrassing. You are the greatest general of our time. How come you only ask for 50 acres of land? You know we don't need 50 acres of land. You just made everybody think that you are an old fool." General Wang smacked his son on the head and said, "You are a young idiot. You don't understand. I hold 2/3 of the kingdom's military might in my command. I command majority of the kingdom's military. Do you think the emperor would sleep well in his bed, knowing that I am stronger than him? No. So if I show the emperor that I have all my faculty, if I show the emperor that I have ambition, then the emperor is not going to trust me. So we are going to set out tomorrow to conquer the rest of the kingdoms. If the emperor already fear and feel threatened by me, his own general, we are not going to do that well in the war. So for the emperor to feel relaxed and not threatened by me, I need to make him feel that I'm senile and my ambition does not extend beyond our little farm." So there, that's another example, another very famous classic example of high-ranking royal subject going out of their way to make themselves look really bad in front of the emperor in order to make the emperor not target them. The next commonly used trick by the royal subject of the old days is total transparency. And the most famous example of this was Lord Orson, Tang Dynasty, during the reign of Tang Tejong. We just talked about Tang Tejong in the last spoken word episode. He's the greatest, many people said he was the greatest emperor of the entire Chinese history, and he's definitely very, very great. During his reign, he's expanded China's territory more so than most of the other emperors, and he ruled with a lot of mercy and was generally a good guy. However, Feng Taizong was not without his fault. Like most emperors, he did have a pretty bad temper and kept being capricious and infatuous and being very demanding. So, during the reign of Feng Taizong, there was a lord, one of his most trusted lords by the name of Guozi. Now, Guozi, when he supported Feng Taizong to become emperor, many people said that Guozi and his family could install themselves as the emperor, but they didn't. And Guozi knew that rumors like that really bugged Feng Taizong, the emperor, because, you know, no emperor liked to hear people say, you know, so-and-so could be emperor if they wanted, and you only got to be emperor because they let you. Yeah, that doesn't make emperors feel very good. And when emperors don't feel very good, they kill people. So Guozi decided to do something very drastic. He commanded his servants to remove all the doors from his palace. So he made his palace and his castle totally free use, free run, free to enter. Anyone can enter any day, any time they want. He didn't even have guards at the door, at the gate. Anyone, civilians, other lords, friends, family, can come and go as they wish. He put in a rule of complete transparency. How bad was this? Well, one day, when one of Guozi's old military buddy came to visit him, this military buddy saw that there's no guard at the gate, and in fact, there's not even a gate. It's just like anyone just welcome to walk in. So he decided to just walk in. And he walked in and went through several buildings looking for his buddy Guozi. And then he came into the inner chamber. Yes, even the inner chamber didn't have doors or guards. So this old military buddy came into the inner chamber and saw Guozi's wife was washing her hair and doing her face. And Guozi, this mighty, mighty lord, was sitting on the side with several dirty towels around his shoulder, carrying a bucket of water and handing soap and whatever cosmetic his wife needed. And basically, he looked like he was a servant. And this old military buddy was so embarrassed that he saw that he quietly left. Unfortunately, even though he quietly left, he didn't keep it to himself. So almost the next week, the entire kingdom knew, oh, Guozi, when he's at home, even though he's a great general and great lord and the mightiest of mighty lords, when he's at home, he's a pussy. He's carrying water for his wife. He's carrying dirty towel for his wife. And he is nothing. He's not even a man. His wife is more of a man than he was. So rumors like that kept going around and around. And finally, Guozi's sons couldn't take it anymore. And so all his sons got together, and they came to Guozi and got down on their knees. Beg their father and say, "Father, you are the greatest lord in the kingdom. Can you please at least put some guards on our doors so people don't just walk in and see embarrassing things like what your buddy was talking about?" Guozi looked at his son sternly and he said, "You guys are just looking at how embarrassing it is now, but you don't understand. Even though I'm great, I'm one of the greatest lords today, but tomorrow I may become nothing. Tomorrow the emperor may become angry with me, and decide to put us to death. So you think I do this to embarrass you guys? I am doing this so no one can go to the emperor to say that we are plotting against him. Because obviously, if my doors are open, there are no guards anywhere, then I can't hatch any plot against the emperor. Because everything I do, even what I do in the bedroom, is completely transparent to the world. I do this so you guys can survive. So, there were people like that in some cases, great lords and generals and advisors, people that really had nothing to hide, that decide to use this tactic, go by the route of complete transparency, so no one could ever tell the emperor that they were hatching a scheme or plotting rebellion or anything like that. So this was the second way that royal subjects would use to defend themselves against the wrath of the emperor. The third one, and probably the most drastic, dramatic one that was often used when, as a last resort, was to pretend to be insane, pretend insanity. This was a really big one. We can find such example as one of the royal ministers by the name of Wang Kai. During the rule of Emperor Zhu of the Ming Dynasty, Emperor Zhu Yuanzhang, the first emperor of the Ming Dynasty. Now, most of you that know your Chinese history know that Emperor Zhu Yuanzhang was known for killing his friends. Like, honestly, when he became emperor, yes, he and his people, they did kick the Mongols out of China. They did take China back. So that's great. He's great, a great emperor for doing that. But after he became emperor, he was so suspicious of all his friends that he turned on most of them and killed them. So Emperor Zhu was not like a good guy. He's not a nice person. Most of his subjects, most of his ministers, it was said that every time his ministers have to go and talk to the emperor, they always made up their will first before they left home, and they always acted like it's the last time they're going to see their family, because you just never knew with Emperor Zhu if he's unhappy or if he even suspect that you were up to no good, he would get you killed without any hesitance. So one day Emperor Zhu got this list of condemned criminals that were condemned to death. Now back then, when people were before execution, criminals that were condemned to death, the list had to be turned over to the emperor, and the emperor had to sign for the execution to proceed. So when Emperor Zhu got the list of criminals, and there was like 300 names on the list, he decided to pass the list on to the Prince Zhu Di, to see if the prince would feel the same way as the emperor. So while Emperor Zhu was vicious and liked to kill people, Prince Zhu Di was merciful and a scholar. So when Prince Zhu Di got the list, he looked at the crime of these criminals and he realized a lot of these people didn't deserve to die. So he took almost half of the name off the list and gave the list back to his father and said, hey, yeah, here you go. I removed half of the name so the rest can be executed. Emperor Zhu was kind of angry about it, so he waited until next morning when his royal ministers came to court, and he asked his chief minister of justice by the name of Yan Kai. He said, Yan Kai, I gave this list to my son, and my son removed half of the criminals from the list. You tell me, am I right or is my son right? I think all 300 of these guys should be executed, but my son seemed to think that only half should be executed. Who do you think is right? Everybody in court held their breath because this was a loaded question. You can't tell the emperor he's wrong, but you don't want to piss off the prince either. So there's almost no way to answer this. Yan Kai took a deep breath and he said, Your Majesty, because you rule by justice and obedience, you demand total obedience, and you are so powerful and mighty, so it's obvious that there's nothing wrong with you thinking these people should be executed because they obviously offended your sense of justice. The prince is a very merciful person, and so the prince is not wrong either for thinking that some of these people might demand a second chance. Everybody thought that was a great answer, right? No, it's like, yeah, neither of you is wrong. You're focusing on justice and your son focusing on mercy. Just different perspectives, that's all. Yeah, great answer. However, to everybody's chagrin and shock, Emperor Zhu smacked his hand down on his desk and jumped up and was totally pissed off. And he said to Yan Kai, I asked you a direct question. Am I wrong or is my son wrong? And you give me an answer that is not an answer. You know what? I'm going to just have your head chopped off and see if anybody in this court ever dare to give me that kind of smooth talk ever again. A lot of people got down on their knees to beg for the life of Yan Kai to be spared. And finally, the emperor said, okay, fine. We are not going to kill him today. And the emperor walked away in a huff. Yan Kai could finally breathe a sigh of relief, but he knew the worst was not over yet. Because even though the emperor didn't kill him today, because so many people begged for his life to be spared, the emperor is not a forgiving person. And Yan Kai knew that the emperor was going to keep fighting fault with him and to get him executed. True to his belief, the very next day, when everybody was gathered in court for their morning session, the emperor said, first item I'm going to look at today is rumors of Yan Kai embezzling money and doing things behind my back. Where is Yan Kai? Get him to come forward and explain himself. And one of the minister's aides came up and said, Your Majesty, Yan Kai cannot come today. You see, after you almost killed him yesterday, he was so frightened. After he went home, he got a fever. And today when he woke up, he was insane. He got mad. And the emperor, obviously, you know, didn't really fall for it. He said, that's bullshit. He was fine yesterday. There's no way that today he's gone mad. Bring him to me. And so people brought Yan Kai to the court. And in fact, indeed, Yan Kai looked totally disheveled. His hair was down. His clothes was open. He was barely dressed. And he was looking cross-eyed. He had this expressionless look on his face, like he didn't recognize anybody. And the emperor said, holy shit, he's either a really good actor or he really got mad. So the emperor ordered one of the royal guard to bring his spear, and he said, I want you to use your spear to stab his arm. Because if he is sane, and when he sees the spear coming, he would flinch. If he is insane, if he's mad and he doesn't know what's going on, then he wouldn't react to it. So the royal guard went out to Yan Kai and stabbed his spear into Yan Kai's arm, blood flying everywhere, and Yan Kai didn't even react to it. And the emperor said, okay, send him home, take him home. I think something's wrong with him. But after a few days, the emperor started thinking, maybe he took some medication. Maybe he used some ointment on his arm so he didn't feel the pain. Yeah, I'm not going to be fooled so easily. So he dispatched some royal guard to go to Yan Kai's house to see if Yan Kai is still mad. And the royal guard went there, and they were led to Yan Kai's personal chamber, and they saw Yan Kai crouched down by the doghouse. Yan Kai kept dogs, and they have like doghouses. And Yan Kai was crouched down by the doghouse, eating what appeared to be dog shit. And the royal guard was so disgusted, they started throwing out, and then went back and reported to the emperor, "Your Majesty, Yan Kai is really mad. He no faking this. He really got mad. When we got there, he was eating dog shit. And yeah, you can't fake that." So the emperor decided, okay, fine. It looked like he really got mad. Let's just leave him alone. In fact, was Yan Kai mad? No. He knew what was going to happen. He knew the emperor was going to keep trying to get him killed. So after he went home that first day, he told his family, "I have to go mad. I have to convince the emperor that I got mad." So he, just like the emperor thought, took some numbing medication so he wouldn't feel pain. And when he heard that the royal guards were coming to check on him, he had his family member make this paste out of brown sugar and black flour, like flour that were toasted to look really dark. And they squeezed them through a bamboo tube so they would come out looking like dog shit. And they had these dog shit shaped pastry on the ground, and that's what he was eating. He wasn't really eating dog shit. So by pretending to be insane, he was able to save his own life. And a few months later, his family member came to court and appealed to the emperor and say, "Hey, Minister Yan Kai is still mad, and he doesn't look like he's going to be recovered. He's still eating dog shit every day. So is it okay that we resign and take him back to the farm and so he can recuperate?" And obviously, Emperor Zhu didn't want to keep paying salary for the chief minister of justice if the chief minister of justice is insane. So he said, "Yeah, okay, approved. Just take him away. Well, I don't want to ever see him again." And so Yan Kai was able to escape the wrath of the emperor by pretending to be insane. And while very, very extreme, very dramatic, this was a tactic that had been used quite a few times throughout Chinese history by high-ranking officers when they were trying to escape being executed or condemned by the emperors. Now, the sad part is, while we look at these ancient emperors and, man, these emperors were assholes. And these people work for them, these loyal people work for them, and they have to defend themselves because the emperor wanted to be unreasonable. Well, sadly, that is not just the old days. Even today, even in our society today, a lot of time, if you have ever been high ranking in any organization or the second in command in anything, you will know what I'm talking about. Sometimes when you are high rank or second in command, you have to be low key. You have to be very careful. You never want to make your boss think that you are better than they are. You never want to make your boss think that you are surpassing them or people like you more than they like them. Otherwise, your boss is going to have all kind of unpleasant way to mess with you. In my own martial art journey, my own martial art practice, I have come across that. I'm not going to name names, I'm not going to give circumstances, but I'm just going to say that when you are the second in command, even in a martial art organization, you've got to be so careful what you say, what you teach, what you, how you act. Because the moment that first in command think that they're threatened by you, oh boy, things can get very unpleasant. So yeah, those emperors were just as human as our superiors of today. Thank you for checking out today's episode. Most likely, I won't get around to a video tomorrow, but Kitten and I will try to do something either Saturday or Sunday. For now, let's welcome in September, and hope you all have a great Labor Day long weekend.